Hey guys, and welcome back to my channel. There is a monumental shift happening right now with how the province is tackling not only affordable housing, but also below market housing in this province. We're gonna talk about a new program they just launched called BC Builds, but we're also gonna talk about a big accountability shift that's happening between the cities and the developers. Now, I'm not gonna go through my formal introduction. If you haven't been to my channel before, I'm Hassan, I'm a Vancouver realtor. One thing I will mention very quickly is I have created a free guide. It's my top 10 red flags and deal breakers guide when buying a condo. I use it with all of my clients when we're trying to determine whether a property is going to be a good investment or whether it's gonna be a money pit. It's in the description box below if you wanted a copy of it. You can click the link there. It's also good if you're considering selling a condo, because I also use this list to make sure we're making sure no stones are unturned when it comes to overcoming objections and preparing a condo to list on the market. All right, so to hop right into it, lots going on in the province when it comes to housing. We're gonna start by talking about BC Builds. This is a provincial government initiative that they just announced last week. And what this essentially is it's now finally a program by the provincial government to focus on what they're calling middle income earners. And so a lot of the programs that we've seen have been based around affordable housing. And we know it's been a government priority to make sure at the, we'll say the lower end of the spectrum, that that they focus on affordability, they focus on getting people off of the streets, working with nonprofits to of course house people that need housing. But there hasn't really been any sort of initiative towards, we'll call it the middle class, the middle income earner. And so what is going on right now is BC Builds is a program worth $3 billion. So the provincial government is gonna offer $2 billion in low interest loans, as well as their own capital injection of about $950 million. So we're looking at a $3 billion total investment and geared towards those that are middle income earners. So you might ask yourself, what is considered a middle income earner in today's market, in today's world? Well, depending on the product type, whether it's a studio, a one bed, a two bed, a three bed, starts at around $85,000 household income per year, and it goes right up to $192,000 household income per year. So if you really think about that, that is the new, I'll say new because we're defining it, that is the new middle class. And that's what this program is going to be built towards. So they want to focus on providing rental housing where people will be spending no more than 30% of their income on the rent. There will be requirements to have access to these low cost financing through the province, including a certain percentage of homes have to be 20% below market rent. So there are a series of stipulations, and the whole premise behind it is, you know, the fear, and I should say, you know, the realistic fear that people working in the city, and we'll take Vancouver for instance, people working in the city of Vancouver cannot afford to live in the city of Vancouver. And so if these people move away, you have essential services, essential employment that gets taken out of the city, we run out of workers. So it's really focused on, as they're putting it, you know, teachers, nurses, construction workers. You know, we've talked on my channel about the labor battle we're in, and when it comes to development, the cost of labor going through the roof. Imagine, you know, people building, developing in the city, they can't live close to the city that they're required to work in, right? And so you look at this kind of in conjunction with what's happening on the federal government side with all the immigration talk, and now they're gonna start looking at targets and them really focusing on certain types of employment workers coming in, including the trades. So this is kind of, you know, looking at it big picture and saying, if we have people moving out of our city, you know, we're not gonna be able to grow the city, grow the economy. We won't even stay flat. So that's what this BC Builds program is about. I believe they've identified 20 sites that they're gonna start developing on this year. They believe that they can get to the construction phase many times within a year versus 3-4 years when the private sector is taking care of the housing element. So they've identified 20 sites, gonna start getting rolling on it right away. I do believe this was something that the provincial government mentioned in their last campaign. We have an election coming up this year, so the timing, of course, interesting. Look, let's not kid ourselves. 4,000 homes, is that going to do a lot for people? No, but I think if we look at it from an overlying concept, I think this is really the important part, is the accountability shift that is now happening between the private sector and the public sector, and the provinces and the cities, which we'll talk about in a sec, understanding and realizing that housing affordability, it is a me issue. It is a provincial government issue. It is a municipal government issue. It is not an issue of the private sector. Now, how it has worked in Vancouver thus far is we've generally been in a low interest rate environment. And before people come at me and say that, you know, interest rates are not high, et cetera, they're the highest they've been in over 20 years. And so when borrowing increases, you know, the feasibility of developing goes down, and profits become very tight. They become nil. We see developers throw in the towel, go bankrupt, foreclose, including another development site in Coquitlam last week is undergoing a court-ordered sale now. That was going to be 21 stories. That's not going to happen, at least through this developer. So more delays in that sense. So, you know, we've been protected. Vancouver has been protected in the sense that low interest rate environment, the demand is always there. And so developers, it's a frothy market. They like it. And it allowed the cities to put pressure. And I use the word ask in quotation marks, but ask the developers to provide, you know, 20% of homes as below market, different amenity spaces, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I would like to say it was a, you know, you scratch my back, I scratch your scenario, because oftentimes the cities would offer more density, and more density would lead to more units that the developers could build. But, you know, when you look at it in hindsight, where we stand right now, you look back at it and you say, who was more density really benefiting? I mean, yes, it's benefiting the developer. There's more margin. They can make more money, of course, more revenue, I should say. But looking back at it, it had even a bigger effect or more of a need for the cities themselves to have more units because of the housing shortage we're in. So it's more so the city would go to the developer and say, you know, you scratch your back, but scratch ours at the same time. And so there was this huge reliance on the private sector to be able to not only bring market supply, but also bring below market supply, purpose-built rentals, rentals within strata condos, all fine and good when rates are low and the demand is high. But we're finally starting to see now what the effect is of higher rates, not just on the consumer ground level, but on the developer level. You know, those developers that are lucky, that own land, that have purchased it they've held onto it for a long period of time, they don't need to move forward on it right now. I say lucky, but they're not making any money. You know, they might have some income coming through on this land, but the fact that they're able to wait and wait it out. So it works for the developer, does not work for affordable housing, does not work for below market housing. And so finally, this year, this is where the accountability is shifting. We are seeing and even hearing provincial government, you know, recognizing that this is our issue. So now we're going to help with the financing. They're going to partner with this BC Builds program with nonprofit housing providers, First Nations communities. They're going to use city lands themselves. They're saying we're going to use underused land right now. Again, low interest loans. So they're really going to incentivize. They will work with private sector as well, but they're no longer going to rely on it. And so that's where the big shift is. There are going to be, of course, some growing pains, right? This is a totally new concept. You know, these 4,000 homes, you know, over the next, I don't know exactly how they've estimated it, but, you know, it's probably a 5 to 8 year sort of plan. So again, it's just a big shift in how they're going to look at development, and specifically below market rental. Now, I was talking about this with some colleagues and some clients, and, you know, some of the pessimists are saying, well, you know, it's just, this is the first step to, you know, the society where you own nothing, but you're happy. Like, you know, be happy and own nothing, I guess is the way they word it, because this big sort of focus on rental. And we have to keep in mind that, you know, at its grassroots level, from a government perspective, they really don't care if you buy real estate, if you own real estate or not. They don't care, right? Their priority is that everyone has a roof over their head in some sort of way. And if the path to get there is through these sort of partnerships with, you know, First Nations communities, they own the land already. If the path to get there is just to provide rentals into the market, that's more achievable for the masses, right? It's crazy to think that this is a program BC builds for middle income earners, yet it's fully a rental program. So essentially, you know, when I was younger, I guess when my parents were, they first came to Canada, we were lower class and really like fighting to get into that middle class. We'll say lower to middle class. And, you know, that whole goal was like, let's do whatever we could, you know, to buy a piece of property. And for my family, that meant we'd had to live on, you know, one of the busiest roads, but we managed to get, you know, a property and kind of squeeze ourselves into that middle class. You know, today's middle class, middle income earner is a tenant. You know, middle class doesn't assure you that you are going to own property in this city or cities around the lower mainland. So it's just a big shift, obviously, in, you know, where we're at income disparity-wise versus real estate values. And you can look at my last video where I talked about fake income mortgages. I'll link to it. But that kind of gives you an idea why there's this great disparity. I've talked about the province. I want to quickly talk about the city. So not many people are aware the City of Surrey has their own for-profit development company, and they are now picking up the pace again this year. They've been around, I want to say, since 2007 or 2008, but they disbanded right after pandemic hit. It was, I want to say, summer of 2020, they disbanded, but right before the market took off. And so now they've decided to get things back on track. They're doing a commercial institutional development in Surrey City Centre, also planning to do a large-scale rental and strata ownership project in Surrey City Centre, Newton area. And so for them, you know, for profit, we're seeing cities now kind of get involved, roll up their sleeves, get their hands dirty. For them, it's all about growth. And actually, one of their mandates is to create an income-producing portfolio. So what is an income-producing portfolio? It's a portfolio of rentals. And so, again, what I just talked about, that shift to own nothing, be happy. You know, the shift, the focus is on rentals. Burnaby, very quickly, they are coming out with their housing authority coming out this year. The reason I want to mention them specifically is they have a very different mandate. So they too are going to get involved in development in their city. But their mandate is getting more affordable rentals into their city. Each year they're losing rentals. They're losing affordable rentals for sure. And that's their biggest priority. So you have these two cities. You have the City of Surrey focusing on profits and growth. Really, you know, Surrey is going to ultimately become the new downtown of the Lower Mainland. So they need to focus on growth. And then you have Burnaby, whose, you know, biggest issue surrounding housing is, you know, the lack of affordability. I think from a business plan perspective, I think City of Surrey is probably a juicier business plan. Their pro formas probably look a lot better. There is, within Burnaby City Council, there's kind of some back and forth in terms of, are we going to be taking on these high interest loans we're not going to be able to afford or pay back because we're focusing on affordable rentals? So that's going to be very interesting to see. No one's been able to master that business plan. So that's something I'm going to watch very closely. Want to circle it back before I end this video to Vancouver real estate, you as a buyer, potentially as a seller. All we've talked about so far is, you know, BC municipalities really focusing on this rental market. If you are considering purchasing real estate and you're sitting on the sidelines, you're not exactly sure what to do, I'll tell you what I tell my clients as well is if you're comfortable with the payments, what the payments are going to look like in today's rate environment. My suggestion is to get into the market as soon as possible if you're purchasing for a principal residence and you're doing it for long term. Creating housing for you to purchase, for us to purchase, is actually becoming less and less and less of a priority. And so when this happens and when all the incentives are being pushed towards rental, and developers start adopting rental as the more feasible solution. We look at Jericho Lands, which is that large-scale development that's going to be happening on the west side of Vancouver. That's going to all be leasehold property. No one's going to own land in that entire development. 90 acres. No one's going to own land. So you have to think long-term, is this a shift in methodology towards leasehold, towards rentals only? And so if you're sitting there wondering, you know, what's going to happen with real estate prices? Are they going to go down if I buy? Like, what's going to happen? Keep in mind, we are coming off of the highest interest rates in over 20 years. And last year, real estate prices on average went up year over year. Somehow we managed to fool the market, I guess, where, you know, real estate became such a hot commodity, foreign buyer ban in place, but yet Vancouver real estate still maintained its value because no one was listing. No one wanted to list their property and move into higher interest rates. So again, if you're someone who's considering buying and you're worried, ask yourself that three-point question. Is it going to be my principal residence? Am I going to be in it long-term? And am I comfortable with what the payments are going to be? Those should be the three questions you ask. And speak to a realtor who you trust that can give you guidance. Make sure it's someone you trust. You know, you can, of course, reach out to me. I'm happy to chat with you one-on-one about it. But just consider that. Consider what we've been through, where the market has been, and what has happened with prices. If you're someone who's selling, what's happening in the current market right now, activity has picked up tremendously on well-priced property, even in the higher-end segment. I saw some properties that were listed between 2 and 3 million selling over asking. So there's that heightened activity that's happening as we head into spring. You know, it happens each year as we head into spring. I'm not actually seeing that huge uptick in listings yet. It's still relatively early for spring market to see that. So I'm going to be watching that over the next couple of weeks. But if you're going to place yourself on market, price yourself correctly and make sure your home is show ready. Do those two things. You might be surprised that, you know, a couple days in, your realtor calls you and says, look, we've been listed for 2 days. You know, I've gotten 10 calls on it. We should be setting an offer date. You should work with a realtor that, in this type of a market, when it's changing, they're able to shift strategy on the fly. You know, we can have a strategy, a listing strategy to begin with, but when markets change, you have to be prepared to change the strategy. So oftentimes I'll talk with my sellers and I'll say, look, we're going to list at this price, but things could change. We may need to set an offer date, which would be great for us, but we're going to determine that, you know, in those first couple days of listing. So make sure you're working with a realtor who's swift, who understands the market, who has a pulse on it on a day-to-day basis, because it is changing on a day-to-day basis. So there you have it, guys. I hope you enjoyed this week's video. If you did, like this video. It sends it out to more people so they can also learn from it. And subscribe to this channel so you don't miss next week's video. And if you live in the Vancouver area or the Fraser Valley, you wanted to talk with me one-on-one about your real estate situation, I'd be happy to chat with you. You can just book me for a call in the Calendly link below. Or you can just send me a text, give me a call, shoot me an email, whatever's easiest for you. We'd be happy to chat. I want to thank you for taking time out of your weekend to watch this week's video, and I look forward to seeing you next week.